All right, everyone. Good evening and welcome to Sinister Wisdom's celebration of mapping queer women's culture. We are so excited to spotlight June Thomas's widely praised book, A Place of Our Own: Six Spaces That Shaped Queer Women's Culture. Tonight, June Thomas will be in conversation with E.R. Anderson, the executive director of Charis Circle, and Sara Luce Look, the co-owner of Charis Books and More. My name is Max Backer, and I am filling in for one Julie Enzer. I am pleased to welcome you to this evening's event on behalf of Sinister Wisdom. We send our love to Julie and her family in Florida, as well as all the folks who have been affected by these hurricanes. Before we begin, as is our custom, we spend a moment for a land acknowledgement. In the United States and around the world, many of us are on occupied, unceded land. I am in what is now Ithaca, New York, homelands and territories of the Haudenosaunee. Please insert into the chat your location and acknowledge the land on which you live. As we think about colonialism in our own countries, I know many of us also think about the ongoing conflict and war in the Middle East, particularly as we have just passed the year anniversary and war in the region continues to escalate. In this moment, may we also pause in solidarity with all who are mourning the loss of life, all who are awaiting the return of hostages, detainees, and political prisoners, and for an end to the occupation. May we all raise our voices for peace and dedicate labor to achieve it. A brief word about Sinister Wisdom. If you are not familiar with Sinister Wisdom is a quarterly journal of lesbian literature and art. Sinister Wisdom started in 1976 and has been publishing consistently since. If you are not currently a subscriber, I encourage you to sign up for a subscription today by going to sinisterwisdom.org/subscribe. A group of monthly sustainers are vital to Sinister Wisdom. If you can give monthly to Sinister Wisdom, please sign up as a sustainer at sinisterwisdom.org/sustainers. Sinister Wisdom sends out emails every month when your gift comes in with behind-the-scenes details and new information about what we have coming in for the journal. I'd also like to remind you about the Sinister Wisdom 2025 calendar, which is now in stock and winging its way to folks who ordered it in advance and who are monthly sustainers. If you become a monthly sustainer this fall, you will receive a free copy of the calendar. You can also order it at sinisterwisdom.org/calendar. The calendar is again gorgeous, and I am excited to share it with you all. All right, a few housekeeping notes before we begin. Please keep your microphone muted throughout the program. If we detect noise from you, we will mute you. As the program proceeds, if you want to show appreciation for the readers, wave your hands at the end of each reading or use the reaction emojis provided to you on Zoom. And of course, feel free to light up the chat on Zoom. Sometimes the best things of our events are happening in the chat. And if you need technical assistance this evening, we've got an array of volunteers tonight: Lisa Barocca, Sam Grassland, and Jules Friedman, all here to help you out. We are also recording this event, and we will make it available starting tomorrow at sinisterwisdom.org/SW134. And all of these links will be provided to you in the chat. We have an hour planned for this event and we'll wrap up around 8 p.m. on the East Coast, including time for our traditional dance number at the end. Our program tonight will begin with a reading from author June Thomas. June, please share a bit from the beginning of your book.
I will, but first I am just have to share that I'm blown away by the people who are here today, some of whom I've met, many of whom I've known for many years, many people who helped me in the writing of the book and in the research. So while I can't, I can't distract myself by chatting with you all, but please know that I would love to do that. So thank you so much for your help in building these places and also in talking to me as I was reporting the book. All right, this is from the introduction. Lesbians get our name from an island, Lesbos, the Mediterranean homeland of the poet Sappho, who lived and loved there more than 2,600 years ago. It's a place few of us will ever visit. I've never been, and I've never seen a photo of Mytilene, its capital, in any of our bars. Lesbians are a people without a home. Perhaps that's why the ones we make for ourselves are so important. My own life has been defined by a search for lesbian spaces. In the early 1980s, shortly after I headed off to college, I bought a gay travel guide to the United States. Some of the activities catalogued in that little brick of a book were either downright terrifying or completely inapplicable to an awkward young feminist like me. So many cruisy areas and adult bookstores. Still, I studied that tome like a holy text. I spent more time thinking about the abbreviations used in its listing than I did about my major, though I never fully unlocked their secrets. LW, leather western, like John Wayne? N, nudity permitted in some areas. Those were areas I definitely needed to avoid. AYOR, at your own risk, wasn't it all? But occasionally I would light upon a W, which meant mostly women lesbians. That letter kept me reading. Since I grew up in England, my interest in the bars of Athens, Georgia, or the erotica emporia of Modesto, California, was largely academic. I wasn't going to cruise to Hunger Canyon or attend a denim uniform night in Dallas, but the existence of this decidedly unslim volume, dense with agate type, gave me hope. Even if I couldn't go there, the fact that there was a bar for W's on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., meant there must be dykes who drank there. If Provincetown, Massachusetts had a lesbian craft store, there had to be women who shopped there. Here at last was the proof I needed that there was more to lesbian life than the two other dykes in the college gay group and that one bar in town that hosted a women's night on the last Tuesday of every month. In the decades since, many of the dreams that were hatched when I was poring over that ancient guidebook have come true. I made awkward conversation with dozens of women in lesbian bars, and despite some near misses, I avoid being injured by an errant pool cue. I spent untold hours browsing the shelves of women's bookstores, attended feminist book fairs in Montreal, Barcelona, and Amsterdam, and eventually worked at a feminist publisher in Seattle. I became an American. I communed with thousands of naked women at music festivals, learning that I was happier if I kept my socks on. I attended heart-stoppingly thrilling sporting events and went home realizing that the best part was bonding with all the other dykes in the stands. I spent ecstatic nights on dance floors, long evenings in collective meetings, and rejuvenating weeks in gay resorts. It was all exactly like I hoped it would be, and it was all completely different. End of reading.
Oh, thank you so much, June. The book covers six different lesbian spaces. Lesbian bars, feminist bookstores, the softball diamond, lesbian land, feminist sex toy stores, and vacation destinations.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about how you selected these sites to write about?
Yes. So the lesbian bar, a place that I've kind of had a conflicted relationship with, felt important and impossible to exclude because it is still, for so many people, the first place they go to when they come out, when they kind of start to find a community or start to look for a community. So I couldn't deny its centrality. At the same time, I wanted to kind of expand that kind of key location to include coffee houses. I see someone here who worked in a feminist restaurant for many years. And who I talked with for the book, because they too felt like an extension of that kind of location that is often overlooked. Feminist bookstores, again, a shoe-in, because that really was the place that I kind of felt that joy, you know, those ideas, the people who came in, the t-shirts that were for sale. I knew immediately how important that space was. The softball diamond, it was a little bit more of an intellectual place for me. I'm more of an indoor person, myself, but I knew that there were many women for whom that space was crucial. Women who, you know, got to enjoy someone from Alpha, and I know there are people here from the Alpha Omegas, said, you know, it allowed her to find her lesbian, her Amazon prowess, you know, that feeling of teamwork, that feeling of physical exertion and being outside and not being in a bar or not being in a cerebral bookstore, just really enjoying, you know, this lesbian existence. The sex toy boutique felt really important because there's no liberation. There's no feminist liberation. There's no women's liberation or queer liberation without sexual liberation. And so many of the pioneers just were so values driven that felt it was crucial, especially because certainly for people my age, and I think for a good couple of decades later, and maybe even now, certainly lesbians were not getting sex ed in school. So we really needed a place where we could go and ask questions and feel supported for that. And vacation destinations, that might be kind of the biggest indicator of my British origins, because I think vacations do have more of a central role in British life. But since there is no kind of, there's no place in the world where lesbians or queer people make up a kind of a natural majority, we're always a minority, even in those kind of neighborhoods, gayborhoods, you know, that we're renowned for, or that they're supposed to be our home. But there are places where, even if it's just for a few days a year, maybe a week, maybe longer, we can go. And even if it's a little bit of a commercial myth, it still feels really great to feel that the culture that's being represented is at least one, you know, partly ours, that, you know, our culture, our aesthetics, our sense of humor, the references, you know, are to a culture that we don't necessarily see represented in our mainstream lives, in our daily lives. So that's why I wanted to include vacation destinations. And there weren't that many others that kind of just missed the cut. Like, those seem to be the natural six, I think.
The six are canon. They are lesbian canon, right?
They are now, yeah.
I remember my first feminist bookstore, like... just yesterday.
Exactly.
Without giving away too much of the book, I'd love to hear about what was the challenging chapter to research and write, and which chapter was just easy and fun.
I would say the most challenging was the chapter about lesbian land. In many ways, it was also one of the easiest, because land dykes, maybe because, this is my projection, they were physically isolated, they loved to write to each other, to share ideas, to share experiences, to share the things that were working for them, you know, how to build that outhouse, you know, on a really bumpy bit of land, or, you know, the challenges they were having, and the joy, you know, the joy of living in nature. And they really did that sharing in places that are still accessible, in these magazines that were, you know, by country women for country women, by land dykes for land dykes. Magazines like Maze and Woman Spirit and Country Women, and they wrote books. You know, they were always in conversation. And it was so amazing as a researcher to be able to find that material and just really see what was going on in their lives when they were, you know, making these new worlds, which was, you know, such an amazing undertaking. It was difficult too, because I did feel conflicted, because many, although, you know, not all of those communities, the ones that are still in existence, are trans exclusionary. And that, you know, feels to me personally like a failing, it makes me sad. It makes me disappointed a bit. And I know also that for many people, especially younger people, but not exclusively, knowing that makes them not want to know anything. It makes them want to reject that whole experience. And that, you know, that so sort of trying to sort of thread that needle was challenging, was difficult, but it also felt super important because I do think, I think it would be a terrible thing to lose the amazing, you know, creativity, the spiritual, you know, dimension that they spent so much time on, you know, the writing, the photographs, the kind of the wild experimentation in terms of, you know, relationships and just ways of living. So much of that life felt important to share, even though there were aspects of it that are really key and very important aspects that I had very conflicted feelings about. Oh, excuse me, I'm just going to mute myself while I cough.
Absolutely. So that one was both the easiest and most difficult. I love that, the complexity there. All these spaces are enduring lesbian spaces. And of course, the feminist bookstore are particularly special to the Sinister Wisdom community. June, please tell me about your experiences in feminist bookstores, all of it. What did you learn in writing the book about feminist bookstores that you did not already know?
Oof. Well,
lots there.
Yeah. And this is one where, you know, I have to out myself as somebody, you know, I'm a bit of a know-it-all. And I was like, oh, this is, I know this. I worked in feminist bookstores. You know, I worked at Lammers in the 80s in DC. I shopped at a ton of feminist bookstores. I worked in other parts of the, you know, the women in print movement. I worked at Seal Press. I worked at Aerolith, which was a distribution company. You know, I had many opportunities to read feminist bookstore news. I see Carol CJ in the chat, so I can't not acknowledge her and her amazing work. You know, I thought I knew that world, and I certainly knew on a deep internal level how important it was because it had been so important to me. But it was, again, it was researching, it was rereading as many episodes, issues of feminist bookstore news that I could find. Like just to see the kind of scale of the invention and, you know, the way that these days I think there's this sense that if you want to grow a business or if you believe in something, you spend money on it. Well, that was just never an option for feminist bookstores. And yet just to kind of see every bit of sort of every strategy, every crazy thought and scheme that specifically, as I write about the women of Amazon, I'll leave it at the end, it was the Amazon Bookstore Collective. They tried so much, and they are a kind of a proxy for every other feminist bookstore, that it was not about a lack of creativity or innovation or hard work or, oh my God, well, we'll try this. We're going to try this. They tried everything. They were so creative. It was so innovative. You know, Amazon did close. Feminist bookstores are not dead. There's been a resurgence. So it was both the level and the extent of the creativity, but also, I think I did feel again like in my sort of in my head that this spate of new stores that are opening, to me that was like, oh my God, they obviously don't know. They don't know how hard it is. They know. They know exactly what they're getting into. They know the history. They know all of the challenges. They know how difficult it is. But they, you know, that is not going to get in the way. They're going into this business, this world with absolutely open eyes. They just also understand how important it is. And they have learned from the past, you know, these stores are intersectional from the start. These stores, you know, they're trying stuff too. I was really, I guess, surprised and impressed by the inventiveness and the historical knowledge of the stores that are opening up even now. They know what they're doing.
Well, I think this is a perfect segue, of course, because I would now love to bring in Sara Luce Look and E.R. Anderson, who run Charis Books and More. So go ahead and pin those folks up here on the screen. June's there too. Perfect. All right. All right. Sara and E.R., I know that June interviewed you for the book. What did you think when June contacted you about working on this project? And how did you first react to reading June's book?
Well, I think I talked to June first, and I got to talk to you about both the bookstore part and the softball part, because I was the one who made Charis have a softball team as a longtime softball player. So I was excited to get to talk to June about both of those things. And it was great. I was excited that June wanted to bring this history into the present moment, because I think so often what we face is the idea that like all of these spaces are extinct, right? Like there are no lesbian bars left. Feminist bookstores don't exist anymore. You know, there aren't land projects when there absolutely are queer land projects happening across the South. You know, there's so many of these spaces. There are queer music festivals, you know, there are, you know, lesbian focused events all over the South. And I'm sure all over the country. And yet there's this extinction myth always, like, and I don't know why that is, but I think that was the thing that I was most excited about, was June countering, using the history to counter this extinction myth, that like, oh no, we're, you know, lesbian culture is disappearing, or you know, the most pernicious idea around that is like trans people are the reason why lesbian culture is disappearing. And as a trans person that has lived, I've worked at Charis since I was 15 years old, I'm 42. My whole life has been centered in lesbian and queer culture. And that doesn't feel like a contradiction in terms for me. You know, it's really important that we can see how there's been this blossoming and opening up without losing, losing that, the initial beautiful parts of all six of these spaces. And I think June did a really great job of that.
I was just thinking about the Charis turns 50 this year. And I think there, I was trying to do a mental count real fast in my head about, I think there's about six of what I call the old school feminist bookstores left, which are the ones that were started in the 70s and are still around. So Charis was started in 1974. And I feel like we get a lot of requests for interviews where people just want to know our history. And usually I'm pointing them to the places where our history already exists, so they don't have to reinvent the wheel. But I also enjoyed talking to June because she was asking, like, similar to what ER was saying, questions about what it's like now and part of our history and how we have sustained ourselves. But that it was not just about our history.
Yeah, I have to just jump in to say that I, in the last few months, I visited two of those stores, Charis and Women and Children First. And it is especially interesting to visit those stores because they feel like the stores that I visited in the 80s in so many ways, like they felt very familiar. And yet they have also evolved. They've changed. You know, there were also things that, you know, didn't exist in the 80s because, I don't know, we hadn't figured those things out yet, but or just like, you know, Charis is now part of Agnes Scott College or affiliated with, and so there were things that wouldn't have been in a 70s bookstore because they weren't selling you know, college memorabilia at that point. But you know, just the to see the evolution and yet also to recognize so much familiarity, just that was so exciting. Yeah, so anyway, I had to pipe up and make that point.
Well, and I think going along with like the fighting the extinction myth is also fighting the like disrespect of history myth, right? That like that somehow some of the contemporary stores don't honor the places where we come from. And I think what Charis has tried to do, and I think our founder, Linda Bryant, is here in the chat with us, you know, is we've tried to really carry forward our history. You know, we celebrate our history in depth every 5 years. We're obviously really celebrating it this year. But a big part of what we do is try and say, like, why are these values so core to our work? And who planted these values in the soil, right? And remember people's names and learn from people. And because Charis has been a multi-generational space since the very beginning, we haven't lost our history. And so there's always been a deep respect for that, even as things have changed. So I think that's this through line that's helped us stay connected to the lessons of women from the 70s and 80s and people from the 70s and 80s, and then move it forward so that it, you know, is relevant to the technologies of the time and all of that, and our politics of the time, which I wish were more different than than they are.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to invite the three of you to think about the past of feminist bookstores and about the future of them, or continue this. First, can you share a few things that you value about feminist bookstores that you feel committed to preserving?
Yeah, I'm going first.
You're going first.
I always think about, I've been at Charis for 30 years now, and the things that have stayed the same and all the ways that we have changed. And I always talk about how many mistakes we've made and how much we've learned from our mistakes, and that we're going to continue to make mistakes and keep learning. Because so many of our policies that we have in place, or the sections that we have in the store, are about mistakes that we made, or things that we had to learn or grow around. And I remind, I think, some newer feminist bookstores owners about that sometimes as well. You go.
Well, building off that, I think we really do have a feminist commitment to conflict. And that does come out of lesbian consciousness raising, right? It comes out of the idea that it is okay to sit in discomfort with other people and to try and build from a place of vulnerability. And actually, that's necessary to do real work with each other. And so, you know, sometimes we'll be in really long staff meetings where we're trying to like get a design approved for a t-shirt. And that is part of our feminist work, right? Like, we'll get annoyed with each other and, you know, make jokes about it, and, you know, and bring in a community therapist to help us, right? Like, we still believe in that. And so we move at the pace that is sustainable for our actual honest connection with each other. And I think that means sometimes we are angry at each other, and we allow ourselves to say it out loud that we're angry with each other. And I think particularly as a multiracial, multigendered, multi-generational space, there are so few places in particularly in the real world, not online, where you can have intimate conflict with people and hold that are different from you, and hold that container of safety where it's like, we're not going to blow up and leave. We're going to stay in this and keep staying in this. And I think that's a model that we learned from consciousness raising and from reading early feminist letters, you know, and seeing like, no, you hang in there and you keep fighting, and fighting with respect and love for each other, but you keep fighting because actually you don't get to leave. You don't just, I mean, obviously people have blown stuff up messily throughout time, but our goal is to be on the higher level, that, you know, the example that folks set for us.
Yeah. You know, for me, I think one of the things that I really took from the story of feminist bookstores, although just to kind of continue on that theme, I think when I, you know, there are six places, and I kind of researched them all separately. And that was one of the surprises, was how many similar stories surfaced in every place. And in most of them, you know, there's this question that I'm often asked at events of like, why are feminists, why are lesbians, why are queer people so bad at capitalism? And that is not this, you know, that is not the situation. It's not that we are bad at capitalism. It's just capitalism is bad. And we choose not to, you know, play that game when possible, you know, and this talk of conflict reminds me of how much of the sharing in all of the publications and in the conversations with people was about teaching each other to avoid mistakes, or if this mistake is going to happen, this is what we learned, you know, not to say don't do this, but just, you know, here's what we've learned. And just that sharing that in many other situations in capitalism would be like, why are you telling people that those are your competitors? Like, that's not how it is. It's not how it is in these communities. But another thing that really I think is very important with feminist bookstores specifically is actually stems from something that ER told me in one of the interviews, which was he pointed me to something that Gloria Steinem had said kind of amazingly. And she told someone once that what she wishes for, you know, for feminists was that there was some sort of parallel with people in recovery who, you know, when they go to a new place, they can find a meeting. And so they can get support. They can get, you know, whatever it is that they need. And wouldn't it be great if there was a similar thing that, you know, for feminists, for queer people, as she said it, for feminists, where you go somewhere or even maybe where you live and you need support and you know where you can find it. And I think in the beginning of the feminist bookstore movement, feminist bookstores found themselves in that role, intentionally or not. You know, they became community centers. They became the place that you called when you needed a doctor or you needed to know, yeah, whatever you needed to know. That was a place you called. But I think ER said, like, now we know, like, this is a big purpose of this. This is a location. This is an actual physical building where people can come. They can sit literally in a room for this meeting that they know is going to happen at 7 o'clock on a Tuesday or whatever, that there's that reliability. There's this, the importance of a place where you can talk about things that might be hard or might just be fun or whatever, but you can be in a room with people. And that feels just so crucial because for me, you know, feminist bookstores, it was a place, again, as I say, where you've, these ideas that you were exposed to that you didn't find anywhere else, the music, the, as I said, the t-shirts, the jewelry, and especially the, you know, the people who worked there, the women who came in, the, you know, and the books, the amazing books that first, you know, made an impact in those stores. It's mind blowing how crucial they have been, how many revolutions they've set off. It truly is a, you know, a remarkable resource that is so underappreciated.
I think a lot about how the internet has changed so much of that. And we used to have books of resources that we don't have anymore because people get their information on the internet. But at the same time, I'm also thinking about, particularly about showing up to a meeting that, so when I was coming out in 1990, before I was at Charis, one of the commitments a friend of mine and I made was we were like, we're just going to go to every Charis program. And at the time, Charis had Thursday night programs pretty much. A program on midwifery. And they were like, why are you here? and it was like, we were like, well, just because we decided to come to every program. And that still happens. We have many more programs than we used to have. We no longer just have Thursday night programs. But there are definitely, I think, folks who are trying to find community, trying to find their way in the world, and just start showing up because it's a thing that they know that they can just go because we are a public space that is open to them.
Mm-hmm. Well, we part of our model is radical hospitality, which is a part of a Christian liberation framework. And people are often surprised at that because they're like, oh, we thought you were a bunch of godless homosexuals and heathens. You know, we didn't, you know. And
both.
Yeah,
you don't have to be either or, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And our framework is really about as more and more people are, you know, don't have a religious affiliation at all, right? And whether or not religious affiliation has been positive in people's lives as often as not in women and queer people's lives. It is an organizing structure and it is a place for people. And as more and more of our structures in our civic life have gone away, we find that people really value having this place that they can come. And, you know, even in our support groups and stuff, people are like, yeah, I haven't left the house in a week. And because I don't have to, because I work and I get my groceries delivered in and, you know, my cat food and everything. And my personal challenge to myself was to put on real clothes and come to this meeting. And, you know, I think we're going to see more and more of that as the internet becomes this omnipresent thing. And obviously the internet was huge for so many queer people, particularly living in rural areas who had no other connection to, they couldn't just go, they didn't live in a city where they could just pop in and see another lesbian, but it also has done a number on a lot of people and really fractured our connection. And so it's really important to us now to be a community center for people who are realizing how much they need to sit in a room with other people and tell stories.
Oh, I love this. June, you were listing off a few things that were found at feminist bookstores, and I wanted to throw in pins and patches. We cannot forget those. And then Bonnie in our audience also mentions music events, which absolutely, I mean, really so much was gotten and still is from those spaces. Now we've talked a little bit about the internet, possibly seeing these spaces as community centers. Can y'all share a little bit about what your vision of the future of feminist bookstores is?
Oof. As I say, I was really inspired by the people who are starting stores. You know, in places, again, in my profound ignorance, you know, I was supposed to, so many of them are in the South. Who's, you know, yeah, no, that's on me. that's my failure to understand. But that they know what they're doing, and they see the importance, and they're very informed business starters. And I also think something that I have seen more interest in lately is just how bookstores, unlike many of the other places that we're talking about or that I've talked about in the book, are intergenerational. You know, that there's you know, bars and softball and vacation, like either because of finances or because of, you know, our kind of physical desires as we age, or, you know, just the way that we change our habits or the way that we're able to play sports, each has a kind of one kind of main age group. But feminist bookstores really always were a place where young people who are just discovering things could go. And, you know, maybe it was the people who work there, maybe it was other customers. I mean, there are just so many possible interactions that they were always places where there was that possibility of interplay and of, you know, just conversations that maybe it's a particular issue in lesbian community, but we're kind of, you know, we're in cohorts for the most part. And so just as their bookstores were, and actually other kinds of stores were important because they were open in the daytime, they weren't on the edge of town. They were more accessible. You didn't have to spend money, actually, of course, to go to a store. As Carol CJ often said, you didn't need to, the fact that there were buttons were often some of those most important things. For some people, a place to go and get a button was like what the bookstore was there for them. And yeah, that just feels so incredibly important then and now.
We still sell a lot of buttons. We still sell We sell a lot of stickers, but we've been noticing that we actually sell far fewer bumper stickers, and now we sell water bottle stickers,
Wow.
But we sell a ton of stickers. I was also just thinking about music just for a second, thinking about the past and the future in terms of when we've been thinking about our birthday and looking at old photos, and I was looking at them with a younger staff person, and she just kept being like, "Who's that?" And who's this person? And I was like, "Oh, that's Chris Williamson at Charis. That's Melissa Etheridge. That's Disappear Fear." Like, different, but the amount of musicians that came through Charis, and that we used to carry records, and we used to carry cassette tapes, and then we used to carry CDs, and then we lost our music distributor, and then streaming happened, and music changed. We don't carry. We don't have that connection anymore like we used to. Mm-hmm. But in terms of thinking about the future, I'm also thinking about the things that so often we're ahead of our times, I feel like, and we're like the stuff we carried and now we no longer have to carry, such as also like menstrual products. We were carrying Diva cups long before they were available anywhere. And then, when my daughter needed a menstrual cup, she didn't even look to Charis because she just did her own research online and ordered one I'd never heard of, that's where we got to. But I'm also thinking about in terms of the future and these bookstores, the newer bookstores that you're talking about, June, people were always surprised that for a long time, there were no feminist bookstores left in California. Mm-hmm. And there are some newer ones now, still not very many, but what it means for like the whole state of California for a long time had no feminist bookstores left, and that, or being surprised that these smaller towns now have feminist bookstores. But if you look at when there were over 200 and something feminist bookstores in North America, lots of tiny towns had feminist bookstores. So I think it's exciting that is happening again.
Yeah, and one of the things that I think, again, like a part of evolution, a part of the changing face of all of this, like here in Edinburgh where I live, there is a radical bookstore, and it doesn't call itself a feminist bookstore. That's not like the name. It's a radical bookstore, but it is a feminist bookstore, and it is a queer bookstore, and it is a bookstore about all kinds of identities. That it has a very wide array of kind of revolutionary books. Really, I know that was another kind of bookstore. Always used to love to sit next to them at events. But anyway, that's another thing. Just as, it always seems crazy to me when people talk, there used to be hundreds of bars and there are only 34 now. Like, well, yeah, but that's true. And that is weird, let's say. But it always seems crazy to me to focus too much on those numbers, because there are so many more spaces that lesbians, queer people, feminists can feel comfortable going to let's just say a hostelry now. It might not be called a lesbian bar, but there are, I feel, as somebody who's, been a lesbian for many decades, there are a lot of places to go. And I feel that same way about bookstores. There may be a reduced number of feminist bookstores, but there are many independent stores that are doing all kinds of, intersectional work, some of which call themselves feminist bookstores, some of which don't, but I recognize them as a feminist bookstore.
It's actually a problem of language coherence for us in the bookstore world sometimes, where, people, I mean, you talk about it in the book of like gay bookstores were men's bookstores and lesbian bookstores were feminist bookstores. There wasn't such a thing really as a lesbian bookstore. Obviously there were bookstores run exclusively by lesbians for lesbians, but for the most part, they were coded as either women's bookstores or feminist bookstores. Charis was always a feminist bookstore. You theorize a bit about why that might be, like choosing to kind of hide behind, whether that's intentional or not, hiding behind the language of feminist as opposed to lesbian. And where we are now, is often trying to sort out within the larger bookselling world as more and more, as feminism, at least popular feminism, has kind of become cool, and some LGBTQ, some representation has become cool, not all, right? We are always kind of trying to suss out, like, well, where does that leave us? Who are we as these ideas have become mainstreamed? And what we often talk about is, like, we're still here for the freaks and the geeks, right? Like, we're still here for the people who really need a home, even within feminism or within the LGBTQ community. Like, the people who go to Pride and feel like, oh God, I don't see myself here. I don't know how to interact here, right? The people who, now that there are so many more spaces, we still want to be holding those folks who are at the margins. Mm-hmm. And a lot of what we've tried to articulate more explicitly is that our space is really about your politics. It's about censoring your queer and intersectional politics, your feminist politics, your anti-racist politics, your anti-capitalist politics, right? And that people of all different kinds of experiences may have those politics. And so it's sort of broadened one of our strongest partnerships is the Auburn Avenue Research Library on African American Culture and History. You know, we are a white owned store, I'm white, and we do a ton of events with them centering often straight Black authors, because that's part of our work. It's part of our work in Atlanta. It's part of our history as a store. And we see that as necessary to the liberation of women, of queer people, of people who are, you know, working class and poor. And so it all feels like this through line of feminist work, but sometimes it can be hard to find those other stores that are trying to do the same kind of work that we're trying to do, because now everybody's like, oh yeah, I'm a feminist bookstore. And we're like, what do you mean by that?
Or there's always been lots of ways to be a feminist bookstore, but mm-hmm. I also think a lot about ownership, and I'm like, I don't want it to be about who owns our store.
Yeah.
Because people are like, is it queer owned? Is it woman owned? Is it Black owned? How is the store owned? And those stores get different kinds of attention, and we're like, but this is what our store is. Our store has an identity all unto itself. And we've also had to think about how to articulate that, because as Yara just mentioned, historically, gay and lesbian bookstores were mostly run by gay men. Feminist and women's bookstores were mostly run by lesbians. And now we've had to start calling ourselves a feminist and queer bookstore, because that's what the public needs to hear. But historically, that's not who we are.
Mm. So interesting.
Ooh, Linda wants to say something.
Ooh. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yes.
Linda's our co-founder of Charis Books.
So hello, everybody. I was in a Zoom meeting with some people the other day, and the person who was leading the meeting is 90, mm-hmm. and she's a former therapist and a brilliant genius kind of person. And she was saying, these are women from across the country who are in this meeting. And I was saying that Charis, I was very excited that Charis is turning 50. And Paula Reeves is the woman's name. Paula interrupted and said, do you all know about Charis? I want to tell you that Charis is the one place that everyone feels welcome. She said, during the years when we were doing, which we still do, a lot of psychological conferences and things like that, so that this was somewhat about her therapy community, but then she expanded it beyond that and talked about her own self, a straight woman, now quite an elderly woman, all that stuff, that the thing about Charis that was different, and ER, you spoke of radical hospitality, and that's what I thought of, was Paula saying, oh no, Charis is the one place where everybody, no matter who they are, that I've ever spoken to in all these years, feels welcome. Mm. So I feel like that's a core part of Charis's identity. And to me, as one of the founders, it's a core part of what feminism is, and that whole idea that every answer, every question has many correct answers. and conversation is what matters, but conversation happens when people are welcome. So that's all.
Thank you.
Beautiful, Linda. And actually, that's a perfect segue. You mentioned the big 50th anniversary celebration coming up for Charis. I wondered if Sara and ER, you might tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah. So on November 2nd, we're going to be having a big party. We'll drop the links in the chat. We would love for folks to, we always talk about coming home to Charis. We would love for folks to join us at that, but we're going to have a whole week of celebrations. So we're going to have a writing session on election day for folks who just need space held. We're going to have art making on the 6th. We're going to have Glory Edom, who is the author of Well-Read Black Girl and the sort of holder of that community, will be with us on the 7th at Auburn Avenue Research Library. We just confirmed that we're going to have flash tattoos in the store on the 8th. Get your bookish Charis tattoos. And then on the 9th, we're having our in-store party and sale.
And on the 2nd, at our party, we're going to have Indigo Girls are going to be there, and Alexis Pauline Gums, who is the author of the most recent biography of Audre Lorde. And Alexis grew up at Charis with ER. And we're going to have Ramalika Imhotep there, who's a poet. Am I missing someone?
Well, I think that's it. Yeah. So we would love for folks to come to that. And the other thing that we just want to shout out about our future is that because we were talking about women's music, is we have this land project that we're working on. In 2018, a woman named Sorrel Hayes, who was partnered with Marilyn Reese, who many of you who are music folks probably know, was a sound engineer for Alex Dobkin and a lot of folks. Sorrel donated land to us in West Georgia with the intention of it becoming a feminist artist retreat. We've been working on it. Sorrel knew that she was dying and so willed it to us. And when she passed away in 2020, we began work on it. We've been quietly processing her archive and Marilyn's archive, working with Duke University and the NYU Music Library so that their important lesbian feminist histories can be preserved and also their histories as musicians. But for y'all who are interested in learning more about that, we would love to talk to you, especially y'all who have music backgrounds, because music is really a part of this land. And we want to carry that forward into the future. So that's a big part of our next 50 years as well.
All right, got some links in the chat for y'all to learn more about that, and also some sweet merch just in case you can't make it live. There is some incredible merch to support Charis Books. And June, what's next for you? What book is in your radar next?
Well, it's a little, not promise I'm not being coy, but it's a little too early to talk about it. However, I have what I think is a banger of an idea. And so, I would love to write a biography of someone who has been involved in many aspects of feminist culture, lesbian culture, since the late 60s. So I'd love to sort of tell some of the stories of those years by telling her life, but not quite ready to say more just quite yet.
I mean, what a perfect place to end us.
Cliffhanger.
Intrigue. We will be waiting for that. Can't wait to hear more. Y'all, thank you so much to our speakers this evening, June Thomas, Sara Luce Look, and E.R. Anderson. Thank you for everyone who joined us this evening and commented and chatted with us in the chat. Saw some great memories and some resource sharing in there. I will save that chat for everyone. It's so wonderful to be with y'all and think with you all. You actually made my job very easy tonight with your brilliance. If you do not already own your own copy of A Place of Our Own, Six Spaces That Shaped Queer Women's Culture, please order one online. There it is. Beautiful. The link is right in the chat for y'all. And again, this video from this evening's event will be available at the Sinister Wisdom website tomorrow. And we have so much fall Zoom goodness happening. Julie will be back next week for the amazing launch of Sinister Wisdom 134, Lives of Common Lesbians. Ah, yes, finally in its fruition, Common Lives, Lesbian Lives. This event will be next Tuesday, October 15th at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. We hope to see you all there. And you can keep up with us, of course, at Sinister Wisdom's website. All right. And just wanted to check in with y'all, see if you had any last thoughts you wanted to share with us before we begin the dance.
I really am kind of a little bit in shock to see how many people who I know or I admire, or I say no, and admires, that's and not or, or who helped me with the book, or who I just think are cool, are here. So I just again want to say, it's great to see you. Thank you.